Tulsa, who our sister Hill. She's going to bring to us our visiting speaker. Praise God. So, amen. Let's say amen for Sister Hill.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, Northside. And to all of our visitors that have come to join us this morning, you are so welcome in this place. Well, praise God. Are you happy this morning?
Yes.
Amen. Blessed of the Lord.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. Well, it gives me it's a great honor and a privilege for me to introduce our speaker, someone I've known for 40 plus years. We're good friends. We have good times together. Amen. She is a native Tulsan, born and bred right here in the city. And she's a graduate of Booker T. Washington High School. Yeah, we have some Booker T. Yes. And she received her bachelor's degree at Oklahoma University, also her master's degree in social work at Oklahoma University. And early in her career, she's always been a trooper and a fighter for racial injustice. And she's an activist. If you want someone to advocate on your behalf, I don't know of anyone any better than Judy McIntyre. She's out there. Amen. Many of you don't know that she participated in the March on Washington in 1963. If you look at some of the old clips that they show on TV, once I spotted her in the crowd, yes, and I said, there's Judy. Well, she comes with a long list of accolades. I'm not gonna get into all of them this morning, but she's a 30-year employee of DHS, retired in an administrative capacity. After retirement, from DHS, she became state representative from 2002 to 2004, representing District 73. And as a freshman there, she was appointed to the speaker's leadership team. Also, following her stint as a representative, she became Oklahoma State Senator from 2004 to 2012, representing District 11. Not only that, she's been a member of the Tulsa Public School Board, and she was also president of Tulsa Public Schools Board. She's had numerous community memberships and accolades, too numerous to mention. So I wouldn't begin to try to enumerate them. It would take too much time. But let me just say, I believe she would agree with me when I say her most important experience was when she made a decision to totally commit her life to Christ. And that's been the most, I believe she betrayed all of that for her total commitment to Christ. Ladies and gentlemen, help me to welcome Senator Judy Eason McIntyre. Amen, amen, amen. Would you stand? Help me to welcome. Yes, amen, amen, amen.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you. I got my Kleenex because it's, regardless of how much cane I raise, I'm the quickest to cry. Okay? And, I brought my laptop with my speech on it, trying to impress Baron and Kim. So I've never done this before, but old school, I got the script. And first of all, let me correct Marilyn. In terms of the title, I am honored to have served as senator, but I'm a survivor.
Amen.
And if you have to give me a title, Maryland for God. That's the title, Survivor. I did survive 2 ex-husbands and breast cancer. And Maryland is right. Committing myself to the good Lord is the best thing that I did. Before I get started with my speech, I'm not going to spend too much time on it, but Marilyn and James stuck with me when I was going through my divorce through thick and thin, and it was a lot of thin moments. And I had the nerve at that time to say, when they were telling me about blessings and stuff, and I said, well, God is good, but he's not good to me. Now, that's how far off base I had gotten. But they never, ever gave up. They never. James would bring me writings and information. Marilyn and I had the opportunity to talk to each other every day at work. And I know I wore her out a couple of times. I know when she saw me coming in, she suddenly was busy. But when I was diagnosed with breast cancer, I was unable to get my minister. And anyway, that Marilyn and James would have been there anyway. But I'll tell you what, I am very, very appreciative. I will never forget it. But they were there, and I do believe they prayed that cancer away. Because you know what? When I woke up from surgery, the breast surgeon said, don't let the unconscious tell you that you need chemo or radiation. I am now 10 years a survivor. Thank you very much. Thank you for all you all have done. The greatest, beyond the friendship, was helping me to find myself spiritually. So with that, and I know I took up a lot of time, I'm going to try to impress Byron and Kim. Okay, y'all. Oh, and one thing, I usually talk extemporaneous. I'm much more comfortable with that because I discovered late in life I was dyslexic. So sometimes the wires get crossed when I'm reading and it sounds like I'm retarded. I'm really not, but they just get kind of crossed. So we're going to give it a try. First of all, thank you for the invitation. And a lot of you I know, and I know over the years that you have prayed for me. Amen. And I do appreciate and I ask for your continued prayers. It's always an honor to come here because it's like being at home. I just feel just like part of the family, but that's because of Marilyn. And I don't know why I always say Marilyn Hill. I just never say Marilyn, but anyway, Marilyn and James, thank you. Black history is American history. Let me say that again. Yeah. Black history is American history. Yeah, yeah. From the beginning, when our ancestors were captured in Africa, survived the Middle Passage, and were sold into slavery in 1619 at Jamestown, Virginia, black people started writing America's history. The African-American experience is nestled in struggle and liberation. It is undergirded by multiple forms of oppression and degradation. It is a story of how we survived the horrors of slavery, the domestic terror and violence of the Ku Klux Klan, the ferocity of Jim Crow Sr., and the lingering residue of Jim Crow Jr. in the 21st century. But in the midst of all that struggling, suffering, we see a lineage and a heritage of perseverance, fortitude, and a dogged determination to reject as false the notion that African Americans are at the bottom rung of American society. Did you know that even as enslaved people, our ancestors made contributions to America? They brought their skills and knowledge from Africa and used them to improve their quality of life along with the lives of their slave masters. Side information. Did you know, and for you young people, when you see the U.S. Capitol on TV, your ancestors built that. Just a little known history. Did you know that on April 19, 1775, free blacks fought with the Minutemen in the initial skirmishes of the Revolutionary War in Lexington and Concord in Massachusetts? Did you know that on December 31st, 1777, George Washington reversed previous policy and allowed the recruitment of black soldiers? Some 5,000 black men fought in the Revolutionary War. And you know why George Washington did that? Because they were fighting the British. And the British governor in Virginia issued a proclamation that he would free any enslaved person who left his master and would serve along with the British forces. And within a month, over 300 enslaved black men joined what they called the Ethiopian Regiment. Did you know that on April 9, 1816, the African Methodist Episcopal Church, which is my church, was organized as the first independent black denomination in the United States? Did you know that on July 17, 1862, Congress allowed the recruitment of blacks in the Union Army? You know why? Because Lincoln and the Union Army were getting beaten by the Confederacy. So they reached down to African Americans. More than 186,000 black men served in the Army during the Civil War, and 38,000 died in that war. So don't ever let anybody say that we haven't done anything to contribute to this country. We died for this country. Did you know that on July 6, 1865, the South Carolina House of Representatives became the first and only legislature to boast a black majority of legislators? There were 87 black men in the House of Representatives. And this was 1868, after the 3 years after the Civil War. And there were only 40 whites. But in 1874, it had returned to a white majority. And when I look at that, when I read that figure, I was thinking about our most recent election that we had here in Tulsa, which was the school board election on Valentine's Day. We had an opportunity to place two people on the board. We had two African Americans on the board. Now we will have one, because we did not vote. In District 3, that represents McLean, and I think this area out here, we had 600 people out of over 16,000 registered voters. In District 2, where we lost it to Caucasian, we only had about 300 people. We have to realize that our forefathers died for the right to vote. Politicians understand who can put them in office and who can take them out. And guess what? Nothing changes if they don't believe that you're going to go vote. Did you know that between July 11th and 13th in 1905, the Niagara Movement, which was the forerunner of the NAACP, was established? In 1915, Dr. Carter G. Woodson established the Association for the Study of African American Life and Culture. It was a way to highlight the contributions of African Americans and to set the record straight that African Americans remained at the heart of the American story. He also wanted to make African American history accessible to all Americans. The teaching of African American history did not happen in a vacuum, but instead it took nearly 100 years before it came into fruition. In 1929, America began to celebrate a Negro History Week in the month of February as a way to communicate the life and the contributions of African Americans. The month of February was selected because it was the birth month of Frederick Douglass, who's still alive, according to, but we'll leave that alone. And Marilyn told me to be nice. And Abraham Lincoln. These two legendary men played a critical role in history with respect to their influence on black life and culture. Throughout this month, we all pause to reflect and celebrate our rich and wonderful mosaic. We examine and highlight the history of African descendants in America and know that each and every one of us has come this far because of our faith in God. It is a time to celebrate our collective strength, which pulled us through the past struggles. A time to recognize our present day victories and to honor those who brought us to this point. This month, we recognize that while our nation continues to confront and break down any remnants of bigotry and hate, we can see the sun over the horizon. Only by acknowledging the success and sacrifice made by those who come before us can we fully understand that what we must do to ensure the liberty of those who will succeed us. During this month, we honor great pioneers like Crispus Attucks, Harriet Tubman, Sojourner Truth, the Honorable Shirley Unbossed and Unbought Chisholm, Fannie Lou Hamer, I'm Sick and Tired of Being Sick and Tired, Supreme Court Justice Thurgood Marshall, Congressman Adam Clayton Powell, who now watch over us like guardian angels. We pay homage to our civil rights leaders like Congressman John Conyers, Bobby Rush, former Panther, Maxine Waters, and other current members of the Congressional Black Caucus who continue to fight for justice. We celebrate our living legends and history makers like Oprah Winfrey, Spike Lee, Colin Powell, Venus and Serena Williams, and many, many more, numerous to list. In addition, we celebrate those history makers who are no longer with us, like Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, astronaut Judith Jemison, Muhammad Ali, and again, too many to list. And lastly, we honor and we continue to pray for our first Black President and First Lady Barack and Michelle Obama. Yes. It is also important we recognize our many unsung heroes and heroes, like all of you here in this room. It's important that we recognize our Black community leaders, both elected and non-elected, across the city, the state, and the nation, who are making a lasting impact on our society, many without any recognition. In the 1960s, with the rise of the civil rights movement, coupled with the Black Power movement and the unrelenting quest for civil rights, African Americans began to expand Negro History Week into a month celebration and lobbied the powers to be in 1976 to expand Negro History Week into Black History Month. As a result of this push, most schools across the U.S. adopted African American history to be included in their curriculum. Interesting enough, in so-called post-racial America, there is still a number of educational institutions that refuse to include Black history as part of our curriculum. I had a bill in the Senate that would have required the teaching of the 1921 massacre. By the time it went through all the process and the amendments, the bill passed, but it was optional. And so therefore, it is not being taught. And in fact, when I was there, I made a habit of always talking with the young people of the pages that came. And in Western Oklahoma, they don't even celebrate Martin Luther King Day in Oklahoma. So if we're going to continue the understanding the history of where we've come from, particular for the young ones, we have to educate our children.
Yes.
Marilyn and I grew up at a time where we were made aware of history. Today, that's not happening with a lot of our young children. And so therefore, they don't know who they are. They have no pride in where they come from. And they assume that our history started with enslavement. The fact of the matter is black history is American history. The African-American impact on history is far-reaching and deeply etched in the social fabric of America. We cannot talk about American history without talking about African-American history. These two stories are unquestionably intertwined. African-Americans have made significant contributions in every field of human endeavor, including science, technology, engineering, mathematics. Who knew about the African-American women who helped to propel a successful launch for Glenn, John Glenn, at NASA? Let me see. Mathematics, theology, art, literature, athletics, politics, and especially the American economy. In every facet of the American experience lies the story of African Americans. Hence, since the inception of this country, with the exception of perhaps Native Americans, African Americans fertilized and impregnated America's soil with the drippings of their blood, sweat, and tears. Though the month of February is set aside to celebrate black history by remembering the lives of our forefathers and mothers who relentlessly sacrificed their lives as martyrs for liberation and advancement of the black community, we must not forget that every day in America, black history is being made.
Yes.
African Americans have struggled through decades of injustice, and we're still carrying on that legacy today. Today, 2017, we continue to fight, especially in light of those who replaced President Obama in the White House. If we sit back and let things happen without questioning or fighting, we will shame our ancestors. Persistence, resolve, and unwavering grit is what is needed to ensure that our children and their children will live in a world of opportunity, justice, and hope. We owe that to them, and we owe it to our ancestors whose shoulders we stand on. We must not be confined to a month of telling our stories, but our stories must be told each and every day. As a wise man once said, if you don't know your history, you don't know your past. And if you don't know your past, you don't know your present. And if you don't know your present, you do not know your future. Finally, I challenge all of you to continue to make your indelible imprints on society. The blood of our martyred ancestors are screaming from the ground and are challenging us not to let their legacy be in vain. We must tell our stories from the boardroom to the courtroom and from the outhouse to the White House. Remember, we are the heart of the American story, and without our story, there is no authentic American story. Thank you, and may God continue to bless all of you.
Before you sit down, we want to hear a little bit about your story from OU, just a little bit about your story.
Now, Marilyn, you know I said I was going to be nice. And we've got a mixed audience. Well, I'm the oldest of four. My mom didn't work, and Daddy worked two jobs, and Daddy wanted Mother to be involved in schools. And by the way, just as a sidebar, when I was on the school board, I don't think I could count on one hand the number of PTAs in our community. But so Mother was involved in the schools, and we lived a pretty sheltered existence. I didn't really understand segregation. We didn't know it. We had everything in this community that we needed. And the only time that I saw whites was when we had football or basketball games, and they sat on one side, we sat on the other, and they left. Mother them never let us go to the movies, because if you did go to the movies downtown, you had to go upstairs. So we did go to the Rex, where you paid 10 cents to get that good hot thing. And then they had Lakeview, you remember Lakeview?
Yes, sir.
And only we could, we as black people could not go but once a year.
Once a year, yeah. Okay. 17th.
Huh?
Was it Juneteenth? They used to call it.
It was where?
Juneteenth.
Oh, it was Juneteenth. See, I could never remember. Thank you. I could never remember. Now, you know. Okay, don't get me started. Oh, God, I didn't know that. That's what it was. So, anyway, we didn't go there either. I can remember, we couldn't try on clothes. That I can remember in the stores, they had colored water fountains, colored bags. It was just crazy. But none of it really stuck because we were so isolated. And I got a chance to, I started working at Southern Hills so I could get out of the house because my parents, kind of like Marilyn and James, I mean, they just own you. But in the end, it paid out. I started work because they didn't know what time I got off work. And, you know, I had never been exposed to, you know, all of that food, and all of that was really a learning experience.
Yes.
But what happened is, it's like if they wanted, I served on the buffet line, I mean, I worked on the buffet line, and the guys served drinks and stuff. And so if they wanted something, they would call you by the N-word and tell you to go get it. Well, we had a jar downstairs that we all used the bathroom in. I've always told my friends, especially white friends, be careful how you treat people who's feeding because you don't know what's going on. But that still didn't mean, I mean, it peripherally, I had the TV on and all of what was going on in the South, but it didn't mean anything. I was a teenager. And we would drive in, and because we knew that they didn't want to serve us, and they would say, we don't serve ends. And we said, well, we didn't come to buy one. We want a hamburger. But if we stayed too long, they called the police on us, and we, of course, left. My minister, and I don't know how, but anyway, with the civil rights movement, and there was a, when they had the March on Washington, we had an opportunity to go. I didn't realize why my parents didn't want me to go, but of course I threw a fit and finally got a chance to go. And I had no idea. I mean, I saw the men on the buildings with those guns. I wasn't frightened because I didn't know what was going on. When we got there, there were black and whites together. I had never seen, you know, people commingling like that. And I remember distinctly, out of all the speakers, Martin Luther King, but he kept repeating himself, but it meant nothing a month later until I went. And that's where I almost forgot my name. That was the very beginning of getting angry. We were told in orientation that about 50 of us, this is how much encouragement you got, that half of you will be gone at midterm and half were gone. They isolated you. One per dorm. There was nothing black in the city. They made you take swimming. If you didn't want to wear a natural, you got locked in your room on the weekends for using a pressing comb. I was living off $20 a month. Daddy said you can spend it all at one time or make it last over the month. So it was no way to do too much of anything. Clara Lupa's son was there with us, and this teacher, history teacher, who told us as black students that if you were black, you couldn't make anything but a beyond the sea. So Kevin got into the class, and he got a D, and he was a smart guy. But I didn't take any chances because Daddy had said that if you failed a class, you were gonna pay for it yourself, and there was no way to pay for it. So I didn't go that far. But I and the girls in the dorm, we talked and played just like kids do, you know, in the dorm. And then when you see them on campus, they didn't even know you. So after a while, and then when, you know, I got the privilege of having my own room because the people would come and they're going to try to make me leave the room And I don't know where they thought I was going, but my mom and dad had said, you're not leaving, so I did stay. But, you know, after a while, it just went from, I was just miserable, but daddy stopped taking collect calls, and so I had to do something different. It was hard, and it was just so confusing, because I was looking at the marches on Washington, the killings and stuff, and then I'm experiencing this, and feeling angry, just unbridled rage and stuff. And, you know, finally I told the girls in the dorm, listen, when I finish talking, you will not hear my voice again. And I never spoke to them. And I focused on, thank God, this daddy had told me I wasn't there to save the world, but to get an education. I did focus on that, and did focus on trying to get on the honorable president's honor roll. But I didn't know how it affected me until I came home and I'd worked in Shawnee and was about 20 some years old, and they were all white clients and had to find them by section lines, which I never knew. And anyway, this guy pulled a gun on me and said he was sick of the ends trying to take over the world and stuff. And so anyway, I got a transfer. That was after my first divorce. And I came back home, and that's when I got involved in the Black Panthers, because I was really wanting to go where the Black Panthers were. In fact, I had started putting out my resume so I could get a job and go join the revolution. Although my second husband and I did not stay married, he probably saved my life, and I told him that, because he was involved in politics, and I had to move away from the Black Panthers after we were standing on Greenwood going to protect the prostitutes. And we talked revolution, but I never saw a gun. And then when the police came and they handed us the gun, I'm like, oh Lord, okay? This ain't the revolution I'm talking about. I remember my dad, I said, he's going to kill me. He's going to kill me. So it was at that point I heard where he said, it's okay to be passionate, but fight from the inside. Don't stand out on the outside throwing rocks. And so when I got involved as a legislator's wife, I had to tone down a lot of things. It was hard, but I did. But I still raised Cain when I needed to. He always thought if he lost the election, it was going to be because of me. We went to a Democratic convention in Oklahoma City, and he came up to me and he had a piece of watermelon in his hand. And I said, what? And he said, a white lady threw this at me because she differed with some political decision. I said, where is she? So I went over to where she was and threw it at her and told her she'd be minus an arm if she ever thought about doing that. Come to find out, you remember Channel 8 Muskogee? It was his wife, but I didn't care. But see, he couldn't throw it, but I could. So I never lost that, as Marilyn said, but I had to tone it down. And as I got older, and actually meeting Marilyn, I mean, she doesn't believe this, but I fought her as hard as I could with all of the reasons why I shouldn't hear what she said, and to take a different route and to be more spiritual. I fought as hard as I could, but she never gave up. And through a lot of life experiences, I finally found that peace that I hadn't had before. And I do attribute it. James is just wonderful. You know, he's more professorial. But Marilyn get down in the trenches with me. You know what I mean? She was always late, but she got down in the trenches. James had a lot of other things to do too. But this is just not political hype. You know, we all need people, and God sends people in our lives that make a difference in our lives. And I could have taken a whole different route if I had pursued where I was going with my unbridled reign, I'm not sure I'd be here. Mm. I'd probably ask some of y'all who knew me to put money on the books for me. I would not be a free woman. So, Marilyn, I will not say more. Okay, I'll finish.
It didn't sound good. It's like I kept touching the screen and it would disappear.
Didn't you enjoy her?
Amen.
So good. Amen. Yes, okay.
Let me just add a little to that. I didn't say, and she didn't either. When we worked at DHS, I supervised her for a number of years. And when we had difficulty in cases, we'd often have to confer with our state office in Oklahoma City. Excuse me, I'm so congested. I hope you can understand me. And many times, I would call on various cases, and there was this one occasion when I called our supervisor in Oklahoma City in the adoption unit, and we disagreed on the action to be taken in the case. And so, Jane Connors, and I went round and round, and she finally said, "Who is the worker in this case?" And I said, "Judy McIntyre." She said, "Oh, I am not tangling with Judy. You can have what you want." She said, "I'm not going to tangle with Judy." So she had that reputation. And I remember another occasion in which there were some group of black workers. We had some concerns, personnel concerns. And the personnel director came down and met with us. And the first thing he wanted to know is, who's the leader of this group? And Judy said, "There is no leader because they kill leaders." His face turned beet red. It was like, okay, that's just a little taste of what I witnessed through the years. But it's been very delightful working with her and knowing her over the years. And she truly has made a transformation. Amen. Truly, truly has. Amen. Let's give her another hand. This was so apropos, the first part of the history that she gave, a lot of the information I didn't know and perhaps some that you didn't know. So this is we have one more week of Black History, before the Black History Month is over, so we're not sure what's coming next week, but just be prepared. Now, we always take an offering for our speaker, but at Judy's request, she's asked us not to take an offering for her, but because she has plenty of money. But she has requested that our contributions be made to her breast cancer survivors group, and that is Soul for Survivors. So at this particular time, we're going to ask you to give a generous offering for the Soul for Survivors group. Perhaps you haven't been touched by, I know that some of you here have been touched by breast cancer. And how many of you know that sometimes you don't really understand things until you go through them yourselves? So I want you to make a generous contribution to her organization this morning, Soul for Survivors. We're just so happy that she came to bless us this morning. And yes, there. We want you to, and you can make your checks out to Northside Christian Center, and we will send one check to Soul for Survivors. Amen? Well, praise God. Let me just say, ladies, you look so good in your hats, and men in your bow ties. Just give yourselves a hand. All of you that, amen. Praise God. You look so good. Father God, we thank you this morning for our service. We thank you for our speaker. We thank you for all the many, many blessings that you have bestowed upon us. And we ask that you just grant unto us bountiful blessings as we contribute to this worthy cause. And we ask these blessings in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen and amen. Glory to God. All right. Pastor Bill.
All right. I just want to say that we were really blessed to be sharing with Sister Judy. And most of you probably have not been impacted so much as you have today just by getting more information concerning Black history. So how many feel like that was important what you heard today? That was important. We're trying to figure out how we can get Judy involved in getting people saved when they're with the Holy Ghost. We haven't gotten that far yet. But I believe she will be open to spread that information too. I mean, we can change. Amen. Amen. So we're going to, Sister Hill is very down to earth and practical, so she stuck with her. That's the reason why eventually the things that she had shared kicked in. Amen. And so I was kind of on the outside, but every opportunity I could get, amen, would tell her about Jesus and tell her about how her life could be changed, gave her information. So somebody like this, I think that if we could equip her with all of the information that we have at our disposal to carry and to run with the message, that Jesus can turn your life completely upside down. How many can say amen? Scripture says if any man be in Christ, he's a what? Amen. Old things what? Pass away. Amen. How many can see a new Judy in her? You can just tell the way she talks. You can see the new Judy today. We always say that school can inform you. The devil deform you. And you can go to school and get informed, but it takes Christ to transform you. Amen. So I thank God, amen, for this life today, because I think that she has made a tremendous impact on a whole lot of people. But I think her healing experience, all of that, tells you the power of God, amen, still prevails. How many know that Jesus Christ is still the same yesterday, today, and forever? How many can say praise the Lord? Hallelujah. So we just thank God for this life. And I tell you, you know, sometimes we are so earthly minded until we know what?
Godly good.
Amen. Heavenly good, right? And sometimes we are so what? Heavenly minded until we are no what? Earthly good. But I think that sharing with people that cross your path is so important. Is that right? And I think that we should never refuse or either neglect an opportunity to talk to people wherever we are. And I think that this is what our salvation is all about. How many can say amen? It's not acting wise and otherwise and acting spiritual. It's, amen, being Super Sally and Holy Joe. But I believe it's really sharing what you believe with others that don't know. Amen. I think that's so important. We're just so happy that God is using us. And I believe that this consecration, God is, amen, putting it on the hearts of all of us. Amen. The main objective is getting established in the Word of God, getting revived, getting rejuvenated, getting, amen, in a state where Christ will become more real to you. I think the objective is to be a blessing to others. Jesus came to seek and to save them that are lost. And how many know that it's not being spiritual, but it's what? Taking Christ, sharing Christ. And how many want God to anoint you?
Amen.
Amen. To inspire you. Amen. To begin to reach out. The scripture says, go into all of the world and what? Preach the gospel. How many can say amen? How many, if you can't preach, you can reach. Amen. Everybody don't preach, but everybody can what? Reach. And I think that, praise God, by us being charged with the anointing and seeking God. The scripture says, seek the Lord while he may be found. And that's the reason why you want to be in a position, amen, to be strong, to carry the gospel. And how many believe that we have power and authority over all power men? How many believe we can do something about the world condition? We can do something about people that cross our path. We can do something about people in our neighborhood. We can change. I think just about every person that have crossed my path, amen, that I know, that got into, that we were close together, I always shared Christ. Even when I was a school teacher, some days I didn't teach a man. I just preached the gospel, right? You know, that was permissible in those days. Amen. But so many of my students are saved today, filled with the Holy Ghost. Some have become doctors and attorneys and very prominent people because I opened my mouth. Paul said, I'm not ashamed. Touch somebody and say, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. For it is the what? Power of God. How many know that this can change anybody that will what? Receive the word of God. Amen. It's the power of God unto what? Salvation unto everyone that believes. Amen. I'm not going to keep my mouth closed. Amen. See what we would have lost out on? See what Sister Hill would have lost? This, the opportunity to impact somebody. Amen. That can impact. She can be another Apostle Paul. Let's call her up and pray for her and get her filled with the Holy Ghost. I bet she did. Amen. But she has the Holy Spirit. But we just want to share this a little bit more because I see something there that God can use in a mighty way. Everybody lift your hands and say, praise the Lord. I want you to stand wherever you are. Is that Quay over there? I can't believe it. Amen. Quay is here. Well, praise God. Hallelujah. We're going to pray wherever we are because we want God to stir us. How many want to be stirred so that you will be able to reach out and to bless others? Amen. The scripture says these signs shall what? Follow them. Amen. Everybody said these signs. What signs? These signs. Amen. That's what believers are known by. There are signs that what? Follow them. Hallelujah. How many glad that signs follow you? Hallelujah. In my name. Everybody just say, in my name.
In my name.
They shall. It is if maybe they what? Shall. Do what? They shall what? Not raise the devil, but what? Cast out devil. Amen. They shall cast. Anybody know people that have devils or demons or oppressed by the devil? Anybody know anybody? Whoa, glory, hallelujah. But the scripture says what? These signs shall follow. Whoa, glory. That's enough to make you run up and down the aisle. How many glad you believe today? He said, shall follow. In my name they shall what? Speak. They shall what? Speak. Sister Brianna was trying to get y'all to speak today. Glory. Everybody said, they shall speak. Say it again. They
shall speak.
When the last time you spoke? They shall speak with what? New. Ooh, glory. Amen. In my name, they shall what? Speak with new tongue. In my name, they shall what? Lay their hands on the sick. Lift your hands up. Look at those hands. Those are anointed hands. Signs shall follow
them that believe in my name, they shall what? Lay their hands on the sick, and they shall recover. Is that true, Sister Judy? They shall recover.
Oh,
Lord. Hallelujah. Glory. Hallelujah. Lift your hands and praise God for the signs that will follow them that believe. Hey, come on, Moshiach. Lift your hands. Let's just pray in the Holy Ghost just for a minute. Amen. Those precious promises God has given every believer. You are not just an ordinary person. God has invested you with power and authority. Glory, behold, I give you power and authority over all power of the enemy. And nothing by no means shall what? Hurt you. Amen. Put your feet up and down. Just place them. Just step up and down. Amen. Hallelujah. How many believe that Satan is under your feet? No weapon formed against you. Open your mouth and say, like, no weapon formed against me. Y'all scared to consent? Amen. Amen. No weapon formed against me shall what? Prosper. Hallelujah. Praise God. So Satan, just say, Satan is under my feet.
Satan is under my feet.
Say it again.
Satan is under my feet.
Say it until you believe. Hallelujah. I have. Everybody say, I have.
I have.
Power and authority. Over all power. I don't know what you're dealing with. I don't know what your hang up is. I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what the enemy has released into your life. But I tell you that God has given us what? Power and authority over all power. Of the enemy. And I'm just so glad now that Sister Dorothy Atoka is here. Just come on down, Sister Dorothy. Yeah. Hallelujah. You gonna lay hands on her? Hallelujah. She is recovered. God is our healer. He still healeth all of our diseases. He still forgiveth all of our iniquities. He still crowns us with loving kindness and tender mercies. He still satisfies our mouths with good things so that our youths are renewed like the eagle. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. Hallelujah. 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 They shall what? Renew their strength. How many believe that God word is true in every case? They shall renew their strength. God has brought her from a mighty long way. We prayed in the fellowship hall the very day that the doctors had given her a very unfavorable report. They even said that aneurysm in the heart, or whatever they said. But God has the last say. Is that right? How many believe that God can turn it around? He has turned it around. He is turning it around. Hallelujah. Because they that wait upon the Lord shall renew. Shall renew. Everybody just say, shall renew. Shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings. Everybody just point here. We're just going to just lay hands on her again. And God is finishing the work that he has begun. Father, tonight, today, in Jesus' name, we thank you, God, for your healing power. You sent your word, and you healed her. And you delivered her out of her distress. Father, we thank you. Hallelujah. We thank you, Jesus, that the work that you have begun, you will continue to perform it. Father, she confessed that you are her strength. You are her healer. You are the Lord. Hallelujah, that healeth her. Father, we thank you in Jesus' name, from the crown of her head to the sole of her feet. Lord, complete the work that you have begun. From the crown of her head to the sole of her feet, inside and out, perfect every abnormality, turn it around, give a perfect peace. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for completeness and wholeness, and her body performing in the perfection that you have created it. Father, we release your healing power to complete the work. Complete the work. Complete the work. Complete your healing work, Lord. In Jesus' name, in every nerve and tissue, within and without, Father, we give you praise and we give you glory. And we thank you, God, for total soundness in every portion of her body. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Everybody say, in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. God bless you. Got anything you want to say?
Just glad I'm glad I'm saved. And I'm glad I'm alive. I thank God for what he has done for me. You're looking at a miracle. When I got to the hospital, you all, the first time, I'm in the middle of a heart attack and they turned me away. I'll tell y'all some more about it, because Pastor didn't give me all that time. But I want you to know I'm blessed.
Yes. Yes.
Hallelujah. All right. Tuesday night, Pastor Stills, those that want Pastor Stills to lay hands on you, he's a miracle man. He has those gifts in operation. And he will be here Tuesday and Wednesday night. You don't want to miss. And also, the 21st is the day that we will terminate for some of the consecration. And we want to continue in fasting until Wednesday. When's the 21st?
Tuesday.
Tuesday. Officially Tuesday. For those that want to go beyond, amen, can feel free to go until the last of the month. Amen. Thank you again, Sister Judy.
Yes,
amen. All right. We want to have another talk with you now, because you understand spiritual things real good now. And we want you to be a crusader. Glory. I mean, hallelujah, in the area, you know, of spiritual. Get people filled with the Spirit. Amen. All right. Now unto him that is able to keep us from falling, and to present us faultless before his presence with exceeding great joy, to the only wise God be glory, honor, dominion, and power, both now and forever.